Good afternoon. Welcome to Lord of Life. Welcome to the celebration of life for Frank Jordan. I want you to know, first of all, how much the family appreciates your coming. And I want you to know that you're invited to come with us to the columbarium for the interment of Frank's ashes immediately following the service in here. And then after the interment, you're invited to the social hall for a time of fellowship, remembrance, and support for the family, as well as continuing the celebration. We want to be mindful of Joan and her health needs, and we will do as she needs taken care of as well. So thank you, family, for watching out for Joan. We're going to start with a welcome on, if you have a hymnal either under your seat or under the seat in front of you. Our service of remembrance starts on page 249 in the very front of the hymnals. The hymn numbers are the big numbers in the back, but the page numbers are little on the bottom right or bottom left side. And we'll start on page 279. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, and to remember before God our brother Frank Jordan, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. The thanksgiving for baptism is on page 280. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth and who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you. We worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Frank. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, in whose name we say, Amen.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming today. I'm going to be singing Wishing You Were Somehow Here Again from the Phantom of the Opera.
The first reading is from Paul's letter to 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Paul writes this: "If I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away the childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And the Gospel from John, the 14th chapter, beginning at the first verse, Jesus says this: "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Well, thanks for getting us started, Becky. So, well, it's my honor to be asked by the family to share words and thoughts and memories about a great man today, and give you all the pleasure of watching a 36-year-old grown man cry and bawl his eyes out. So we'll try to get through this today. He's remembered as a son, a brother, uncle, friend, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and husband, and better known as Fran, Dad, Pop, Grandpa, Gramps. That's what my son called him. And, or as I remember most often growing up, "Frank, Frank, Frank." I joke and love, Grandma, I joke and love. The eldest of four siblings, his interest as a boy led him to joining the military between the Korean and Vietnam Wars, working on machinery. When he returned, he met my grandmother. They went on their first date, New Year's, and got married that May. Must have been love at first sight. Soon after, and probably the most important piece of this quick biography to yours truly, he and my grandmother had their first child, Liz, and soon added three more to the mix: Tom, my Uncle Rich, and Sue. But to him, though, they'd always be affectionately referred to as Chuck, TJ, Thatch, sorry, Uncle Rich, and Kaweel. Thinking back and piecing together descriptions and conversations, he's best described as a man who valued hard work, smart political and financial discourse, and above all else, family. A typical weekday for my mom when she was younger would be my grandfather returning home from work, greeting everyone, which included tossing my Aunt Sue into the air high enough to where her head would hit the ceiling, sitting down at the dinner table where they may discuss a current event or the efficacy of balancing a checkbook. And then my grandfather would stand up, pour himself another unjangler, which was code for a glass of wine, and when I say wine, I mean the absolute finest wine available in the day, stored eloquently on the top shelf of the refrigerator in a perfectly manufactured cardboard box. So he'd pour himself another unjangler, go to the room, and rearrange the speakers of the record player to be right up against his ears on the floor, which may have been the inspiration for headphones later in the day, and blare his favorite Motown tunes while the kids danced around him in joy. Other memories: winters were filled with snow and sledding, summer spent going to the shore where everyone was instructed to stay out of the sand and don't pick the daisies, or rainy days walking to the nearby market instructing the kids to avoid the big water, which was basically a small stream of water running through the underpass tunnel. For me, I can recall three memories of my grandfather that will stay with me for the rest of my life. First, I remember going to my grandparents' house and getting to play Wheel of Fortune on what they called at the time a computer. I can eagerly remember arriving at the house and running to the back closet where it was kept. My grandfather would open the case and store on the big floppy disks, loading them in the operating system, punching in a bunch of commands, and put in the Wheel of Fortune disk. It was even better when that same computer was gifted to me for my birthday with a word processing software and printer. I was the first kid in the neighborhood with a computer, and my love for technology was born. Second, I often had the pleasure with my sister of staying with my grandparents when my parents would travel on vacation together. Coincidentally, Arizona. One morning I woke up and my grandfather was reading the newspaper at the breakfast table. I asked him what he was reading about. He went on to tell me how the nation's debt had risen to above $4 trillion. This was 1993 for those keeping track. And walked me through the mechanics of the government borrowing to pay its budget. And so I became the first third grader to ask questions of his teachers in school about the national debt, the running deficit, which I'm sure they were very excited to field. It may come to a surprise to you all that I'm in financial services today. Lastly, it would be a huge miss not to talk about one very specific date as it pertains to my grandfather, January 1st, 2000, or as it will be remembered by many, Y2K. My first two memories paint the picture of my grandfather as a man who was an early adopter of technology and a close follower of geopolitical events. The convergence of these two factors led him and many of similar interests to believe that society, which had heavily shifted to being dependent on computers, who would have thought about that today, would be in a world of hurt on New Year's Day 2000 when all the computers would shut down, being confused when dates went from 99 to 00. Some prepared for this potential by purchasing a few extra candles, matches, and maybe made sure that the pantry had some extra canned goods just in case. My grandfather took it upon himself to convert the entire basement into what I could only refer to as a prepper's paradise. I mean, we're talking non-perishable goods, lining shelves upon shelves, boxes of candles and matches, kerosene torches with enough fuel to have lasted the Maccabees 8 years, let alone 8 days, and of course, the lockable bunker for safety. Oh, and enough space, of course, to store some boxes of Unjangler. If you're wondering what happened to all this stuff, I'm pretty sure my grandparents lived off of non-perishable goods for the next 3 years, and some of the items even made their way to Arizona, and we found some in the garage. Oh, on that note, if there's anyone in the market for 12-gauge shotgun ammo, enough for themselves or perhaps a small militia, talk to my dad after the service and we can figure something out. As is the usual case in these situations since his passing, I've had the chance to really reflect on who my grandfather was, and this is probably where the waterworks start, so sorry, while he was alive, going beyond just the memories, but making connections about who he really was and what he meant to me. Damn it, I was going to get through. To start, I can't recall one single instance of my grandfather ever really being mad or angry. As my other grandmother would describe, he had the patience of Job. Now, I'm sure he was, but those instances haven't stayed with me. He always viewed the world from an optimistic, very patient lens, valuing a good joke or a good laugh over much else. In fact, probably at the beginning, I can hear him laughing now, probably already past the point of wheezing. I don't remember him being the life of the party at a family gatherings or reunions, but everyone was happy to see him and wanted to talk to him and catch up. And he was always up for a game, ping pong, pool, darts, horseshoes, board games, you name it. He quietly focused on solutions rather than dwelling on problems. He liked to tinker, try to make things better, like the numerous heavily used cars that would line his Mooresville driveway. And if he had an idea, he had to see it through to completion. Maybe his Y2K preparations were a little bit of an extreme example of that. As a husband, he was entirely devoted to my grandmother and cherished her as much as a best friend than anything. I can still see him making her smile and laugh. As a father and a grandfather, I was going to cut this part out. I should have. He was the backbone, the foundation, the gentle support system of his family. He'd often greet me with a, "You math," for the record, that was my nickname. "How are you, my boy?" He'd listen intently, ask questions, and always seemed so proud with no judgment. And as I was leaving, I'd always get a, like everyone else would get, "Do good work, kid. I really hope you think I was doing good today." And as a great-grandfather, he taught that regardless of age or health, you can still bring joy to others. My son, Nace, after an afternoon visit a few years ago that consisted of playing with cars, a light game of running around playing tag, and sitting and talking together in the red recliner, said, "I like Gramps. He's a really funny guy." It's going to be hard to top that. Over the last few weeks, I've reflected on what I might say to him now that he's gone. Something to say that really encompassed everything he was. Well, here goes nothing. Fran, Dad, Pop, Grandpa, Gramps, and Frank, thank you. Thank you for your joy and laughs, Rest in peace. Rest in peace, knowing that you were loved by many, your love and support was felt by all, and that you shaped our lives for the good, and maybe for some more than we realized before. Thank you.
Words from the heart often come out as tears. Frank was born September 20th, 1937 in Reading, Pennsylvania, and he entered eternal life September 21st, 2021 in Sun City West, Arizona. Frank was a gentle soul, loving, kind, never saying a harsh word. He was a man who knew his responsibilities to family and to church. He lived as an example for others, just like the words of 1 Corinthians, patience, kind, giving, loving. In the end, Frank was still that gentle man, kind and loving, concerned for others above his own needs. That last time after he'd fallen and he was back in the hospital needing a hip replaced, Joan was there in the pre-op room waiting, and I came in, and all Frank was worried about was who was going to take care of Joan. He may not have known all the nuances of what was going on in these last years or months, but he never forgot how much he loved his family. It hurts when one in the family hurts, and now the family is hurting because that sweet man is gone, but gone from our sight, not from our hearts or our minds. Frank has entered eternal life. Frank lives on in the presence of God and the house that God has prepared for him, the place that has been prepared, because our God is a God of detail, promise, and fulfillment. Through Jesus, we hear the detail of what God has in store for those who enter eternal life, the feast that has no end. Jesus won't drink again until he drinks with us in eternal life, that box in the closet of good wine. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and he tells us that his Father, our God, has a mansion with many rooms, and Jesus has to leave this earth so he can go and help prepare that place, that particular place for when that time comes. Jesus tells Mary and Martha in John chapter 11 that he's the resurrection and the life, and he tells them that even though they die, yet shall they live, and even though they live, they will never die. And he asks Martha, do you believe this? Do you believe this? Martha answered, yes. Yes, Lord, I believe. By Frank's baptism, by his confirmation, by being married in the church, by raising his children in the church, Frank said yes over and over to God. Yes, he believed. In Hebrews chapter 10, we read that he who promises is faithful, and that is our God. God is faithful to his promises to us through Jesus Christ. We walk with God in this life, and God walks with us through eternity. He who promises is faithful. I go to prepare a place for you, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, in Psalm 23. We are all in good hands. Frank was in good hands his entire life. God called him and claimed him since his baptism. And at that time, it was necessary. God called and claimed him again. This time, just the day after his birthday. But we thank you, our dear Heavenly Father, for loving Frank so much that you wanted to take him home with you. God bless you, Frank. You are loved. You will always be loved. Amen. We'll continue with the words of the Apostles' Creed, the words of our faith, found on page 282. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at that right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I'm going to read a few prayers. They're called petitions, and after each one, I'll end with God of mercy, and I invite you to respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray together. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrows on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The commendation is this. We commend Frank Jordan to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Frank Jordan. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. After the benediction, we'll sing our closing hymn, and after the closing hymn, we'll start listening to this beautiful song called Scars in Heaven. After that is played, we will take the ashes over to the columbarium, and again, you are invited to join the family as we inter Frank's ashes there. The benediction is this. May God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever. Amen. We'll sing How Great Thou Art.
Oh, my God. If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now?